See everyone out this morning. Let me get the suggestion. I was running behind a little bit. Leslie asked me to announce that our fall party for our kids is going to be on October the 30th, and she needs some volunteers to help hand out treats to the kids for the trunk and treat part of our day. So if you can help, an adult, and you can help Leslie with that, it's on the 30th. What time, Leslie? 4 o'clock? Start at the center at 4, right? For the treat part, okay. All right, good. Okay, I hope you took note of the announcements that scrolled across the screen. And again, thank you to Whitney for... I asked her about that. I said, how do you do all these graphics? And she says, oh, just like that, you know, piece of cake. Not for me, but she does a super job with it, and I hope you take a note of them and all of our announcements. Next Sunday is going to be a special Sunday. We want to highlight that, though. It's going to be Youth Sunday, and the youth will be conducting our service, and we'll have a potluck afterwards, and any donations for the meal will go to supporting our Christmas family that we will adopt this year. So invite your friends, invite your families, neighbors, anybody to come out, because the kids always do a super job with Youth Sunday. And so come out and support them as well. Okay, any other announcements? Anyone else? Okay. Debbie asked me to give you an update on the Lord's Acre sale. She received an additional donation, so the total this year was $12,100. So that's a really good response from our Lord's Acre sale. Okay. Any other announcements? Let me run through birthdays and see who we got coming up. Trey Haney has a birthday on the 16th, and on the 19th, Callie Renner has a birthday. Callie, how old are you going to be, 14?
15.
15, wow. Ooh. You're moving up there. And John and Heather have an anniversary on the 20th, and our illustrious pastor and choir director and what other title you have has a birthday on the 21st. So, happy birthday.
Oh.
All right.
Okay.
Main cow.
Yes, sir. Oh, Olivia's on the 28th? Well, let me make sure. Yep. Okay. Good. Well, that's a pretty good month, isn't it?
It is.
Okay. And let's see. Congratulations, Samantha. She has a new car. Nice Toyota parked out there, white. So she's giving free rides, and she might even let you drive it. So, that's great. That's a sign you're growing up. So, Callie, you got that in your future, maybe, huh? Talk to your dad. Okay, any other announcements? What was that? Oh, I'll tell you what, if you followed the events, Facebook and text and email, Stephanie has a major testimony for how good God is. If you didn't know, she got rear-ended by an 18-wheeler, stopped on Asheville Highway, turning into a Dollar General. He was going full speed, and she walked away. She has one little red spot on her arm, and that's all she got. So praise God that he was watching over her, and we're thankful that she walked away with just that scratch. Now, I can't say that much for the car. Her car was more than scratched, so, okay. Any other announcements? We're glad you're here. It's going to be a great day today. So let's bow. We have an opening prayer, and we're going to our service. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for watching over Stephanie, and she was able to walk away with just that one little scratch. We give you our praise for that. We give you our praise most of all today for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who by his life, death, and resurrection has enabled each one of us to live blessed in this life and even more blessed in the life to come. We thank you for his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who indwells each one of us and who is in the midst of our service today, as he always is. And so we seek the anointing of his presence as we worship you and give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to our worship this morning. Isn't it great to know that God knows you by name and he called you? Isn't it great to know that he knows you so well that he knows how many hairs are on your head? Skip? Yeah. It is great to know it. He knows us so well, and yet he calls us and he says, "You're my children. You are the apple of my eye." Today we will worship him as his family, multi-generational, reaching up, reaching in, reaching out, and praising the Lord Jesus Christ, the one true and living God, creator of everything that is. Let's stand as we worship him with our opening praise today.
Radiant
says that we all make mistakes. We all sin. We all fall short of what God's perfect plan for our lives is. We're just not perfect. There's only one who is perfect. Because he was, and he died for our sins on the cross, we can come boldly before God today and confess and have the assurance that he is faithful and just to forgive us if we will confess. And we do that silently. Then after a moment of silent confession and prayer, we sing our response. So let's bow as we pray and confess. Father, you've heard our confession. Now let your grace, and grace from your hand, be upon us. Amen.
You as perfect. Just love on him and let him love on you. Thank you.
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger. Walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters could ever wander, and my faith would be even stronger in the presence of my Savior. Set a fire down in my soul, let it flame and make me grow. I want more of you, Lord. I want more of you.
Good job. I invite you to turn your Bibles for our responsive reading to 1 Samuel chapter 15. We'll be reading verses 12 through 26. If you're using a pew Bible, it's on page 442. And as we always do, I'll start off with the first verse. We'll alternate reading, and then we'll read all together verse 26. 1 Samuel 15, beginning verse 12. Early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul. But he was told, Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor and has turned and gone on down to Gilgal.
When Samuel reached him, Saul said, The Lord bless you. I have carried out the Lord's instructions.
But Samuel said, What then is this bleating of sheep in my ears? What is this lowing of cattle that I hear?
Saul answered, The soldiers brought them from the Amalekites. They spared the beds of the sheep and cattle to sacrifice to the Lord your God, but we totally destroyed the rest.
Stop, Samuel said to Saul. Let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night. Tell me, Saul replied.
Samuel said, Although you were small in your own eyes, did you not become the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel.
And he sent you on a mission, saying, Go and completely destroy those wicked people, the Amalekites. Make war on them until you have wiped them out.
Why did you not obey the Lord? Why did you pounce on the plunder and do evil in the eyes of the Lord?
But I did obey the Lord, Saul said. I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king.
The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder. The best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal.
But Samuel replied, Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams.
For rebellion is like the sin of indivision, and arrogance like the evil of adultery. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king.
Then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. I violated the Lord's command and your instructions. I was afraid of the people, and so I gave in to them.
Now I beg you, forgive my sin and come back today, so that I may worship the Lord.
But Samuel said to him, I will not go back with you. You have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you as king over Israel. May the Lord bless to us the reading and hearing of his holy word. Sermon hymn is number 617, Onward Christian Soldiers. It's going to be, the words will be projected on the screen as well. And we dismiss the children on the last verse.
Yeah.
sermon scripture today is Romans 1, verses 1 through 6. It's found on page 1746 in the Pew Bible. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through the prophets and the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who, as to his human nature, was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God, by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and for his name's sake, we receive grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Rick, for reading for us this morning. And I hope everybody got the central message of that passage in 1 Samuel. Everybody get that one? You may have had to, even though it was descriptive in that passage of what Saul's disobedience was, if you want to go back at the whole story, you need to back up to the beginning of the chapter. But basically it was that God had told Saul to destroy the Amalekites, everything. And sometimes we have trouble when the Old Testament talks about destruction of people and women and children and animals. But that was the command of God for Saul to destroy everything. But what Saul did was, and you know, and sometimes we have well intention and we do things sometimes out of the right motive, but it can still be disobeying God. And Saul said, well, let's get the best of the sheep and the best of the animals, and we'll take it to the temple and we'll sacrifice it as an offering to God. That's a good thing, right? It's a good thing to offer sacrifices to God, to praise him and to give to him. But yet that was disobeying what God had told Saul to do. And that's why Saul got in trouble. And that's why the anointing of God is, you know, Saul as king left him, because even with good intentions, he disobeyed the voice of God, the word of God. So today the main topic of the sermon is obedience. Well, I want to go back to a previous sermon a couple of Sundays ago where we talked about hearing from God, because there's a connection. God, Saul heard from God, but yet he disobeyed God. So I'm going to go back and just, if you were not here that Sunday, this would be kind of a review. But it was a passage based on verses from Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, where the church at that point was in danger of falling away from the faith. They had heard the words of the gospel, but the words had really not sunk in. They basically knew what they were supposed to do, how they were supposed to live, but they were not doing it. They were, as Saul, sliding into disobedience. They heard the words, they heard the voice of God, but they lacked understanding of what those words were to them, and they lacked a commitment to be in obedience to those very words of God. And I made four observations in that sermon. I want to just kind of run through those again. And the first one was just mentally assenting to the truth of the word of God is not sufficient to be a disciple. You know, the Bible says even Satan believes, but there's a big difference between just saying, I understand the word of God, or I know what it is, and being a disciple who lives in obedience to that word. Not just on Sunday morning, not just on, quote, big religious issues, but every day, whatever God is saying to us, we live in obedience to that word. And so it's not enough to just mentally assent to the truth of the word. We must be in obedience to it. And that was the second observation I made, that James, if you remember from James chapter 1, verse 22, it says, don't just listen to the word of God. You must do what it says. And then you remember what James said after that? He said, if you're only fooling yourselves if you listen to the word, but you don't obey the word. And then the third observation I made from that passage is that if we struggle with understanding what the word of God is, we have a witness to that word, and that witness is the person of the Holy Spirit. If you go back and remember what Jesus told his disciples in the Gospel of John, he said, when the Spirit of truth, and that's the Holy Spirit, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will tell you what he has heard. Now, where does the Spirit hear from? Who does the Spirit hear from? Well, the scripture obviously says it's God himself. God speaks, the Spirit hears, and he comes and he talks to us and shows us what truth is. He shows us the direction that God wants us to go in our lives. And then the fourth and final observation that we talked about on that particular sermon was that Jesus confirms his word to us by miracles, signs, and wonders to build up our faith and to show us not only the truth of God, but the very presence of God is with us and guiding us, and we're called as believers to live in obedience to that word. I want to move on then. If you'd like a copy of those points, I can give it to you. But the main way you can get it is go out and pick up a DVD, which we have on the table, of all of our services. And so if you missed a sermon and want to go back and rehear it again, just pick up a DVD out there on the table and go home and plug it in. But I want to sort of turn now to Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 6, a scripture that Rick read for us this morning. And I want to talk about obeying what we hear. And we'll give you 9 keys to obedience, 9 scripture keys to living in obedience to God. And Whitney's going to project those up for us this morning. So key number 1, the passage is from Judges chapter 2, verses 16 through 17, which I'll read for you, and then she has the key projected up there for you. Key number 1. But first, let me read the scripture. Judges chapter 2, verses 16. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hands of the raiders. Now listen to this. Yet they would not listen to their judges, and the judges of the way that God spoke to the people, but prostituted themselves to other gods and worshiped them. Unlike their fathers, they quickly turned from the way in which their fathers had walked. And notice the way the fathers had walked. The way of obedience to the Lord's commands. So the first key is, when we spend time and fellowship with obedient Christians, we will also be obedient. Let's talk a little bit about that. Why did the Israelites fall into disobedience? The scripture says they prostituted themselves. They chose to commit themselves to things other than God. And they let those other things become their priority. Very simply, They let those other things become their gods. They worship them. So what is the key to obedience from these two verses? You have it on the screen. As long as we are close to those who are obedient, we will also be obedient. What does that mean? It means very simply what the Bible tells us, that the Word of God encourages us not to neglect the assembling together in worship. When we're together with faithful people, we're together with obedient people, we not only worship with them, but we involve with them in prayer groups or Bible studies. We are encouraged by their obedience. One of the things we heard at the conference that we were at week before last, and this is a statistic given, I'm not sure about the percentage, but it's obviously close to what it might be. One of the speakers said that when our young people go away to college, they get away from home, they get away from their faith family, they get away from being involved with people who listen to the Word of God and who walk and live by the Word of God and who are obedient to the Word of God. When they get off to college, 90%, that may be a little bit high, but it's a big percent, 90% walk away from their faith. That's shocking, isn't it? Now, they may not walk away forever. Many of them come back. But we lose a lot of our young people who get away from their faith family and they get into a secular college or university and they hear all kinds of unbelief and all kinds of faithless theologies and conversations, that many times they walk away from the faith. And the reason is that they're cut off from the exposure to Christians who are obedient to the faith and who are obedient to the Word of God, and instead are exposed to all kinds of doubt and unbelief. When we spend time in fellowship with obedient Christians, we will also be obedient. That's the first key. The second key comes from 1 Samuel 15:22, which we read today. It's just kind of a review. In chapter 15, God instructed the Israelites about how they were to attack the Amalekites. But Israel destroyed not only the people, but they destroyed the sheep and the cattle, except they spared the very best. Because I said earlier, they wanted to worship God and to please God. And when God questioned them about this disobedience, Saul tried to rationalize his sin of disobedience by explaining, well, Lord, we spared the best of the sheep and cattle in order to sacrifice them to you, to bring to the temple. But you remember what Samuel replied in verse 22? Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of God? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. Being religious is not enough if we go to worship out of some other reason than devotion and obedience to God. Let me say that again. Being religious is not enough if we go to worship out of any other reason than devotion and obedience to God. So the second key to obedience is devotion and obedience should be our motivation for worship. We come out of devotion to God. We come because God says, do not neglect our meeting together. So that's key number two. Key number three, Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 through 9. This is talking about Jesus. Let me read you two verses. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who, what? Obey him. You know, we can learn obedience through life circumstances. Suffering, difficulties, problems. For those of us who are parents, what's one of the primary ways that our children learn to obey? Through a little bit of suffering once in a while, right? A little thump on the backside, they learn to obey. That doesn't mean God puts suffering on us to make us obey. Let's get that cleared up from the very beginning. God does not put suffering on us to teach us lessons or to get us to obey. But it does mean that when we go through trials and difficulties, we learn to trust God and have faith in Him. And it's that struggle as we go through those circumstances in our lives, putting more and more trust and faith in God, it produces obedience. Obedience, when we come to realize that God is working for our good, and all He asks of us is to listen to Him and to obey Him. Key number three, we learn obedience through life's circumstances. Let's be real clear though, God doesn't put those circumstances on us, the bad ones, to teach us lessons or to get us to obey. But through them, we depend and trust more on God, and therefore we hear His word, we begin to obey His word, because we know that He's working for our good. In all things, He's working for our good. Key number four, passage, one verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 13. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, men will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. This verse is linking obedience and our generosity. One of the great verses that talks about our giving and our generosity is from Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. It says that we are to bring the whole tithe in the storehouse. And God said, in fact, test me and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room for it. So how do we test this promise of God? We test it by obeying and being in obedience to what He says. And what did He say? Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. Key number four to obedience is tithing is a test of obedience. Key number five, 2 Corinthians 10, verses 5 through 6. And Paul wrote these words, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of the Word of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. Notice that last part of that verse. Once your obedience is complete. Obedience is a process. It has a beginning point and has an ending point. And the ending point of the process of obedience is completeness. Completeness is another word for maturity. Our process of obedience begins with immaturity. We learn to obey God in the little things. as we obey him more and more, our process of growth moves us into maturity and into completeness. Once we learn to trust in the little things, then we begin to trust in the bigger things. And we reach that place of maturity when we turn away from faithless beliefs and discussions about the key teachings of the Scripture. And instead, we base our faith and actions on what God says to us through His Word. And we don't have time to go into some of those discussions, but you know what they are. People speak disbelief, unbelief, and doubt. They speak words of hurt over people's lives. It could go on and on. But the point is that obedience is a process. We learn to begin with the first steps of obeying in the little things. And then God begins to reveal to us the greater things. And that's what maturity is about. Key number 6. 1 Peter 1, verses 13 through 15. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who calls you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. When our knowledge of God increases, when we hear his voice more clearly, and we begin to obey it more deeply, we move from ignorance to completion. And the fact of the imminent return of Jesus should be a motivation for all of us to be obedient to him. Now, you begin to hear the arguments, no man knows the day or the hour. Yeah, that's true. But not knowing opens a possibility that the hour is very imminent. And for one, I want to be, when Jesus returns, I want to be obedient. I don't want to be, when he comes at that moment, to be doing something that's in disobedience to God. I don't want to be a place, I don't want to be in a place or have a thought on my mind or doing anything that is contrary to the word and the will of God when Jesus returns. So key number 6 is that the imminent return of Jesus should motivate us to be obedient to him and obedient to his word. Key number 7 comes from Acts chapter 5, verses 29 and verse 32. Peter and the apostles were brought before the Sanhedrin in this passage. They were told, do not go out and preach about Jesus. Shut up. Don't want to hear it. Don't want you saying it. I'll paraphrase that just a little bit. But Peter and the other apostles replied to the Sanhedrin this way. We must obey God rather than men. In verse 32, they went on to say, we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who, what? Obey him. God gives the Holy Spirit to those who live in obedience. When Peter and the apostles were told to stop preaching Jesus, their boldness to defy the Sanhedrin came not from within in them, but it came from the power of the Holy Spirit given to them because they chose to obey God rather than to obey men. It's impossible to please both God and people. If you choose to try to please people, you're going to end up in disobedience. If you choose to try to please God, you will end up in obedience. We must obey God and His Word. Key number 7, it's impossible to obey both God and people. Faithful Christians sometimes have to choose who they're going to listen to and to obey. And hopefully we make the right choice. Key number 8, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. And it begins with you also. The you also in this passage is me and you. It's all Christians, believers. You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. When the scripture says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in Him will never be put to shame." Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. And listen to this. They stumble because they disobey the message. We stumble whenever we disobey the Word of God. Those who don't listen to God and don't trust His Word and have faith will be disobedient and will fall. Key number 8, listening to God in faith and trusting His Word produces obedience. And the last key, number 9, from Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 6, our scripture today. All Christians are called to witness to the power of God that change their life. And the basis of this truth is in the fifth verse, the last part. So that others will believe and obey Jesus, bringing glory to God. We're all called to witness the power of God that changed our life so that others will believe and obey Jesus, bringing glory to God. When life circumstances, like Stephanie getting rear-ended by 18-wheeler, and she posts on Facebook, "God is good, God protected me," that's a witness. And it encourages people who are going through difficulties to believe also and to obey also so that we bring glory to God. But here's the truth. And it's so obvious. We can't be a witness to something we don't have, can we? We can't be a witness of something we don't have or we don't do. To have faith in the Word of God and to live obedience to the Word is a sign of a mature believer. The Bible simply says to us, have faith in God. To have faith in the midst of trials and struggles and difficulties is an act of obedience, and it's a commitment to the Word and the promises of God. Biblical faith is not a fantasy, nor is it a naive trust that's based on wishful thinking or desperation. But biblical faith is a commitment of wholehearted obedience to Jesus and to the truth of His Word. Key number 9, biblical faith is a commitment to wholehearted obedience to Jesus and to the truth of His Word. We're going to sing a closing hymn. It's a hymn of commitment. Trust and Obey, a song that we all know. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. As we're singing this song, if you are either having trust issues or you're struggling with some area of your life where you're more tempted to walk in disobedience instead of walking in obedience, while we're singing, we'll have our prayer ministers available if you'd like to come down and have prayer about any area of distrust or any area of disobedience that you're struggling with. We'd be glad to pray with you and for you about that. But our hymn of commitment is number 454, and we'll have the words on the screen. Trust and obey, and we stand as we sing. Thank you. invite you to turn your attention to our prayer list on the back of the bulletin. I encourage you to be in prayer for these folks that continue to need our prayers. Edie passed on an update about Myra Jeffers, who's Dr. Woolsey's receptionist at the Green County Vet Clinic. She did have surgery for her thyroid issues. Went good. In fact, it was a lot less involved than they thought. And so she can be taking some medication to regulate her thyroid and on the way to recovery. And Craig asked we pray for Amy Calkin, who has throat cancer and will start treatment for that as well. So be in prayer for those two folks and those in our prayer list. So let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word today. Thank you for reminding us of how important it is to seek your direction and will for our lives. And where we seek that direction for the little things and we walk in obedience to it, we do move on to maturity when we hear the greater things that you have for us, and we learn to obey even those things so that we might grow up mature and complete in every way. We ask you to touch every need that's on our prayer list today, for those that need spiritual healing, those that need physical healing, those that need healing in their relationship, those who need a better job. The list could go on and on. There's no thing too small, God, that we know that you care about the least of things in our lives. All the little stuff, you care about that, and you have a word for us about even those things. And you also have a word for those greater things, too. And we know that your word says that by the stripes of Jesus, we're healed. We don't always understand all the pieces of that, but we know that your word is truth and that your Holy Spirit can show us and lead us into all truth. So open our hearts and minds today to begin to walk more in obedience to your word. And we do thank you that you were with Myra Jeffers when the surgery took place, and that the results are much better than they had projected. It just reminds us you are good, and you're good to us all the time in every situation. We ask you to be with Amy Calkin, Lord, that we all are joining in our prayers for her and praying, Lord, for this healing of the stroke cancer. And Father, we all rejoice today that you were there with Stephanie, that looking at the pictures of her car and the fact that she was sitting still and rear-ended by an 18-wheeler, and she walks away with one little scratch. It's just a miracle. We thank you for that. We thank you that she walks in obedience to you, and she is faithful to claim your word for her in every circumstance of life. And it's through those circumstances that her faith in grows and increases, and her obedience increases as well, to bring her to that completion that you want for her life. And you want that for all of our lives. We thank you that you've given us the way to walk in obedience. You've given us your perfect word that's always good for us. But most of all, you've given us your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who shows us the way by his life and example of how we are to walk in obedience and faith. And we remember him today as we join praying the prayer that he taught his disciples and for us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue our worship and bring to God our morning tithes and offerings. As we go into our work week and to our homes, that you call us to walk in obedience and walk in faith. And we thank you that the presence of your Holy Spirit helps us to do that every day. And now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit dwell in our lives both this day and forever. Amen.